Tweens in Godot are a very powerful tool that lets you craft animation directly from code. They are a great way to animate a UI and make visual gameplay reaction responses very quickly. You can create a tween from anywhere inside code. So let's create one to move our ball inside our ready function. First, we use the getTree.createTween to spawn our tween and save it to a variable. Tweens are created inside the scene tree and are not directly related to the node that creates them, meaning you can animate several objects besides the one it was created from. We can use the tween property to animate properties of our objects. We set the object we are changing, the property to change, the final value, and how long it takes to reach that. So here, we are going to move our ball to the position 6, 5, 0 in 1 second. And there we go, a simple animation. But doing things like this, we always move the objects to that position. So changing the start position will give different movements, and at different speeds, as it will reach the destination in 1 second. So let's change this. First, you can use colon to change the properties variables directly. So let's change only the position.x and move it to the x6. Like this, it will still work the same. But now, you can change the object's height and it will keep the movement the same. You can also use multiple tween actions that will animate one after another. So let's add a tween property to move our position.y to 3 in about half a second. And then move it back to x-6. Godot will execute each tween action at a time, creating an animation. We can also add the sRelative call after the tween property. This will add the value to the property instead of setting the final value. So, if we add the sRelative to our y position, it will now go up by 3 units. Let's set it back to a small increment. We can now use the set loop to make the tween repeat the animation. And because we use the sRelative to increase the height, the object will keep going up indefinitely. Another thing we can do is add delays before a tween action to stop the animation. You can call tween interval to make it wait for any amount of seconds. One common mistake with tweens is not properly cleaning them up, and you might start seeing these warnings. When we create a tween, it is created inside the scene tree, but they are still moving other objects. So when we have a running tween and the animated object no longer exists, you get these errors. Usually when reloading scenes. It won't break the game, but let's fix that. You can use the tween.bind method to bind the tween to a node. These have a lot of advantages. The tween will be destroyed if the object no longer exists, cleaning itself up. But even beyond that, now the tweens will share the object's process mode, so you can have the tween animation pause when the object is disabled. That's nice and all, but the movements are still very rigid, so let's start making our tweens look better. Tweens have a very easy and powerful way to make fluid animations with the use of transitions and easings. You can use the setRuns and setEasing to make the value change more dynamically. Look at how much better the same tween moves now. You can find a quick reference guide for the various types of transitions in the Godot docs. It might look confusing at first, but it only shows how the values will move to reach the destination. When using the setRuns without easing, the default easing type is in-out, the bluish line. So in our example, we use the cubic transition with the ease-out, meaning you go initially fast and ease its speeds at the end, slowing down before the destination. And in the return animation, we use the default in-out easing. We start slow, pick up speed, and end slow. Here's another example using the back transition. It goes back a little before moving, making it look very springy. And like that, we can make very interesting and complex animation. Like this one. Here, two different tweens were used to make the animation simpler. You can use multiple tweens to animate the same object as long as they are not animating the same property at the same time. Here we used one tween to move the position, and the other to move the rotation. A very simple but nice looking animation. You can also make a tween execute multiple actions at once, instead of sequentially. To make a tween action execute together, use the tween.parallel. This will make the tween action after it execute together with the previous one. Now the ball will move and scale at the same time, but the next actions will be executed normally after that. And to visually improve things, you can change a call to parallel just before the tween action. You can also use the set parallel call to make everything after it execute together. Here's a more complicated example. We call set parallel to make the tween after it execute together with the action before, to move, scale, and change color together. And then we can use the tween.chain to await all animations before executing the next actions. So then, we execute this section together to change the color while scaling back, and when it all finishes, we execute this section to stretch it while moving. And then we'll disable parallel actions, making everything after it run sequentially again, going up and down, and make only the very last action execute together, making our object disappear while moving down for the last time. As a side note, if you don't see your animations again when reloading the scene, that's because we are using the tween to directly change the material, which changes it globally. If you are changing material properties, make sure your material is local to scene, to make change local and fix this. Now, everything's working. Now that we have learned the basics of tweens, let's see some examples. Here we have a clickable character. We can use a tween here to give the user feedback that the object is selected with a simple scale animation. We start by connecting the input event signal. This is received when mouse events occurs over the object. Here, when we left-click the object, we create a simple tween to change the scale and make the object pulse. Using a combination of transitions, easings, and different durations, we can get a very nice click response for the object. Here's another example. We can make a nice UI animation for hovering over and pressing menu buttons. And here we use two new great features of tweens, tween states and callbacks. First, we use a class variable to store the pressed button tween. This allows us to check if the tween is already running or not, so we can avoid doing the hover animation. And we can easily check that with the isRunning function here. The other feature, callbacks, is used inside our button click animation. We use the tween callback function to call our scene change after the rotation animation is done. We use the getRe.changeScene_to_packet to change the scene, and we can use the .bind method to that to pass parameters to the function inside the tween callback, the same as calling it like this. The ability to check tween states also makes them a great alternative to await timers. With await timers, you never know if a timer is already running or not, making their use limited. Here's an example. In this game, when we go over to the red areas, the NPC will wait 1.5 seconds and then go to that position. With await timers, we can cancel the previous timer, so when we enter several times, it is called several times after. What we can do instead is use a tween callback and use its setDelay function to make a timer. This will execute that function after the set time passes. But with tweens, we can see if they are running and kill them before the function is ever called, giving us all the control we need to manage our timers. Now we can cancel the callback, making the NPC only move if 1.5 seconds passes without entering the area again. And here's something extra. You can use the tween method to call a function with the interpolated values. You pass the function to call, the start and end values, and the duration. The tween will then call the function with the values from start to end as its parameters. One important thing to note here is that even if your function is receiving a float, it might only get an integer value as a result. To fix this, we need to make sure Godot knows the start value is a float by passing 0.0. Now it will receive the correct floating values as a parameter. And that's it. The basics of using tweens in Godot. You can now craft powerful animations directly from code, making UI animations and gameplay response reactions an easy task. I hope you liked this video, and until next time.